had a chance to listen to it, I encourage you to do so. That is, in fact, how I met you, Abbi, right?
Yes, you were on the podcast. You were my guide.
With so many other, like, really fabulous people. And I just still think it is such a great introduction to how to look at art. And I loved how you said that, you know, there's no wrong way, right? Yeah. And I think I was just took away how closely you looked at things and then what great questions you posed from all of that.
Well, thank you. I mean, the making of that podcast was one of maybe the best experiences. And I think that we would ideally be doing this in person if we could, but the COVID of it all. And so we're doing it on Zoom, but I got the opportunity to be in the museum with Anne. Like, there was not a lot of people there. Like, I got to go into the museum when no one was there and get this, like, behind the scenes. It was just one of the great experiences, and the goal of the podcast and kind of this, like, listen, I went to art school, but I'm no art historian. I didn't really even minor in art history at all. But I'm just curious. And I think it's about making it accessible. And that was always the goal with the podcast. And kind of now I'm just, like, yearning to, like, talk about art and look at art and kind of go away from whatever nightmare is currently, smacking us in the face. I'm so excited to get to talk to you tonight.
Thank you. I feel exactly the same way. And I really can't wait until the moment when we can actually be on the same coast and in the same room again. But in the meanwhile, like, thank goodness we're living in the age of Zoom room and all this other stuff.
I know. So.
Anyway, before we plunge in, I have to say a quick thank you to our sponsor, Bank of America, whose partnership lets us share MoMA's collection with the world, both online and through virtual programs like this. And then I thought, just for our audience out there, hello to all of them. So tonight, yes, right. Hi, everybody.
Hi, everybody.
Abbi and I.
It's just my parents and my extended family. Hi, guys.
Yeah, I'm sure my family probably is not tuned in. They're off watching, I don't know, the Great British Bake Off or something. Good. Anyway, so tonight, Abbi and I have chosen four different works from MoMA's collection that we thought it would be really fun to talk about together. All of these things, I should say, are currently on view in MoMA's fifth floor galleries. All are by women with, shall we say, surrealist connections. You'll see some names that I think are very well known, like Frida Kahlo, and others that maybe are lesser known, like Claude Cahan. And I think mostly it's just, like, a wonderful excuse to kind of take a deep dive into looking at art together. But along the way, we can think maybe about questions like, you know, what is surrealism? Who knows? And what did it become in the hands of these women artists? And then I think, Abbi, to your point about the podcast, like, making art accessible, I think also that'd be one of my goals for this evening, is that the larger project of making the contributions of these women artists and under-recognized figures in some cases within the history of art better known. So,
yeah, definitely. I was so excited to, I didn't know, I think I only knew Frida.
Out of our three. Oh, that's so great. Yeah, so, that is so great. Yeah. So should we, I don't know whether I should ask you, like, we should ask each other the question, well, just what is surrealism?
Well, I think that's better. I think everyone would agree that you would be the better one to answer that one. I don't know. Maybe you go.
I could take a stab, but I'm sure your answer would be funnier.
As in inaccurate.
Well, right. So I will give you, like, the art historian's definition of surrealism. And then I think the other thing to talk about, though, is the word surreal. And I think those two things, so the art historian's definition of surrealism might be something like this. It was an art movement launched in the early 1920s based on the conviction that poetry and dreams and the unconscious mind had the ability to shape our consciousness and a new society. You know, and I think it's all of like that bound up. It was founded by poets. It was founded by writers, and visual arts came into the picture sort of after the fact in a way. And I think it's important to, I don't know, talk about or recognize how the early poets who launched the Surrealism moment had all come out of the experience of World War I in one way or another, and had a profound distrust of the society and the rationalism of society and the institutions that had led to this unprecedented carnage. So a certain skepticism and a turn inwards in yeah. order to change the way we see was part of their program.
Okay, I have a couple questions and thoughts off of your art historian definition. Okay, so I did like a truly like a Google search.
No, I love Google searches.
Just to be like, because I feel I haven't been like my head in the art in a while, mm-hmm. and I wanted to come prepared, and then I pulled back because actually being unprepared is the whole point of this for me, but. When I was there for a moment, I think like the artist that coined the phrase, I caught a little bit. Is it Breton?
Well, yeah. So I'm André Breton, I guess is the, I don't know, my French is no good, but Breton. See, the one that really, when we get to the artist, Claude Caon, that's what I really have to like try hard with the French. But André Breton was the author of the first Surrealist Manifesto. But I think the word Surrealism itself was coined by a poet named Guillaume Apollinaire, sort of who, you know, was celebrated by the younger Surrealists for the magical irreality of his poetry and his work, you know, skill with language. So Surrealism was not Breton's term, but he is the one who wrote it into a manifesto and made a program out of it.
The thing I saw about him was that he was like maybe minored or studied psychology, yes. psychiatry, yes. and maybe worked with Freud, which I found fascinating. I mean, it is the study of dreams and how dreams, or what you said about how dreams are, you said it way better, but.
Well, I think I was saying how dreams can have as much of a validity for the way that we see and approach the world as like our thinking rational selves, and to trust and listen to and those types of unbidden thoughts.
It makes me think of, well, one, I just want to say this because I feel like Surrealism, and maybe I'm wrong, maybe every movement kind of has an umbrella of like mediums, but it feels like this movement like encompasses like the artists use all different kinds of mediums, whereas some movements feel like very much like a painter's movement or, mm-hmm. Which I love about this. And also it really makes me think, and this is maybe another Zoom, Anne, but it really makes me feel like think about, because a lot of Surrealist work really feels psychedelic.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Like, I don't know. It really like tapping into like the dreamlike is also feels like that, that unconscious mind, right?
Yes. I think so. Things that come unbidden, right? And that go out of control, which I guess is psychedelia a little bit, or hallucinates, things that are hallucinogenic and the, we were talking a little bit about, so did the Surrealists all get together? Did they talk a lot? But so they did these things like hypnotic sleeps. You know, they pursued strategies of writing and art making designed to try to give up conscious control and see.
I love the therapeutic angle of it.
Yes, no, it's true. And Breton, I'm looking to see, because I saw someone, Sean was like sending us a question. I'm supposed to look at these questions.
Oh, I'm sorry. You're totally.
No. I'm just, I want to look at you. I have to look at the questions.
There's a lot going on.
Like a lot of stuff here. Oh, so some Jared Sage has asked us.
Okay.
Would you say female surrealists who were influenced by psychoanalysis more often accepted the role, of the feminine anima or rebelled against it? Wow. Oh, I think that's beyond.
Wait, what was the second half? They accepted the feminine what?
The role of the feminine anima or rebelled against it.
The feminine anima? I might need to find for me.
I wonder if that, now this is going to show the limits of my, right? True confession, feminine anima. I mean, I know that this, many of the male surrealists often looked to women as muses,
right,
or as, right, objects for inspiration as opposed to practitioners. And so maybe feminine anima is sort of the inspirational force, like maybe it's a way of saying muse, feminine anima, that which animates ideas.
I think that the men did. I don't know if that's the question or not, but it actually is similar to the question I was asking you earlier, because I was wondering if there were these like salon like meetups in the surrealist movement when it was coming about, after World War I and that. And if it was like so many of the other movements sort of, and maybe this is my own shit coming in here, but if it was like a boys club. And I'm excited because we're focusing on four women artists today and their voices feel so singular. And right. I know this was like a very collaborative movement.
Yes.
And like what you're saying with the hypnosis, like I wonder if these women were included or if they, I mean, if we're talking about going into Claude first, I think it's a perfect transition because I don't know why I want to say they for them, they feel almost, and like, I want to say they almost feel anti the movement. Or not the movement, but anti, like, whatever the collaborative, I don't know. And maybe they were wildly in the collaborative part of this, or I don't know. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yes, no. I know what you're saying. So Claude Caha and Caha's partner in Art and Love and Life, Marcel Moore, from what I've read, participated in surrealist circles. They were all also very active in the nascent lesbian community in Paris at the time. And I think that this image that we're looking at, which is one of many self-staged, self-portraits that Caha made, often in collaboration with Moore, this one, not necessarily, were private, sort of, private stagings, private images, made for the two of them, not for the larger group. So I'm not quite sure. I mean, I think it's when you say they went against all that, I think they certainly were not trying to be the muse to any.
Yeah, right.
Or the, and they didn't conform to the image of sort of the child woman, the femme enfant, which is another surrealist trope for the way that women were treated or regarded. I mean, I'm trying to think, for some reason, I'm looking at the Caha, but I'm also thinking about Merritt Oppenheim, because I know she writes about how she would go to like the Café Blanche and hang out with.
Right. And maybe it's not, maybe that wasn't even, I guess I'm just, I guess like in my small knowledge of art history, it feels like one boys club after another with like an occasional.
Yes.
You know, yes. And then that, it just, these specific women feel so, and not to say that they weren't in those groups. They just like, I mean, I'm just so drawn to this work. Like, so Anne showed, we had a lot of images, a lot of artists, and we sort of narrowed it down. And I was not familiar with this artist. And I'm like, I mean, I just am so drawn to this. And it's in a little glass, right?
Yes, it's like a bell jar.
Yeah, I don't know. This is so fucking intense. I'm sorry. Can I not curse on MoMA?
No, please do that. And I mean, I love that, you know, fucking intense, because it's so physically small. Like, we're not getting that on the screen, but the power of this four by six image is just uncanny, to use a Freudian term. And
it's just the small, but look, seeing you. So it's just, it feels like you're kind of caught. It's like this person is very much seeing you.
Trapped in the gaze. And I kept thinking, oh, you know, when I look at this, at first I was going to describe it. I Googled the definition of bell jar, because I thought, oh, I want to know what that is. And it's a, you know, it's a glass covering used for protecting delicate things, which I kind of, looking at this and thinking that. And I also think it's so interesting. My first inclination was to describe it as Kaha's face reflected, but at the same time, it's projected within. No, and I think that the membrane between what's inside and what's outside, and what are we looking at and who are we looking at? Like, those are all, what's reflection, what's reality, what's real, what's surreal.
And the little bit that you told me about them and their partner, that they both use pseudonyms. So like, this isn't even their real name, right?
Right. So actually, so Leah Dickerman has sent us in a question. Lovely Leah. Leah asks us, is Claude Kaha a female surrealist? Did Kaha live as a woman? And so I think, although people out there may correct me, the answer is, in her time, yes, Claude Kaha lived as Lucy Schwab. And Claude Kaha and Kaha's partner, Marcel Moore, called each other by their first names in public and by and large in private. And today we have no idea how Claude Kaha would choose to be referred to. So I think, yes, they or them could well, you know, that just wasn't an option in Paris in the 1920s for Claude Kaha and Marcel Moore. And all right, so we were talking about that they chose these pseudonyms, which, as I understand, were they used Claude Kaha and Marcel Moore for their creative collaborative works, both in, and I liked that you were drawn to Kaha, because Kaha was not only a artist, but a writer and an actor. And Kaha and Marcel Moore were very involved in the theater, and they came up with these pseudonyms for their collaborative practice together. And oh, right, because I had wanted to ask you, Abbi, if you had ever thought of using a pseudonym.
I think I missed my chance. For Broad City, Alana and I, we weren't going to name the characters Abbi and Alana. They were going to be Carly and Evelyn. And then a producer was like, you have to make them Abbi and Alana. But on the flip side, like, not doing that has drastically influenced my life, because I think people feel more than maybe if I was Carly on the show, that they just feel like they know me, which is the biggest compliment in the world. But it's also like very confusing for me sometimes, because I'm like, am I exactly her, or should these be defined? You know, so I totally can see, I can see that benefit. Like, who knows in the future if I would want to ever write something in a different genre, maybe to do it not under my name. That's an interesting, maybe I'll be Claude. Something else. Maybe I'll pick a not traditional feminine name.
Yes, right. I mean, one scholar who's written a lot about Kaha's work, she doesn't say this about pseudonyms so specifically, but she talks about how the photographs and the acting out were a way of being free. And I just thought that was so beautiful. And it's almost thinking of how taking another name or
this is 1925.
What, circa 1925.
I mean, if someone put this, not that any work couldn't feel that, but this feels like, this feels so right now.
Yes, I think I just want to send you all these books on Kahap because it's the tip of an iceberg.
Yeah, it just, I only imagine what they were, how like risque, like I wonder how their work was received at the time.
Yeah, I mean, as I understand it at the time, it was largely private, done for each other. This said, you know, there are all those images from kind of Weimar Germany, right, of women or of cross-dressing, that's sort of chic. So I don't know the answer to that question.
I mean, just real quick, I know we're going to go to another artist, but I happen to be working on a project right now where we're actually doing a lot of research on whether it's cross-dressing or sort of like the butch femme dynamic. And
right.
I mean, for a long time, it was illegal for women to wear pants.
Yes, right.
You got arrested for not wearing a certain number of feminine clothing.
Right.
I mean, this we're talking here in the States, but
In Paris, yeah. Too, in the 20s. I don't know when it starts. So this photo that they just flashed up on the screen, another one of Cahin's self-portraits. I read that it's cropped. And like, if you see the full image, Cahin is wearing a full suit and smoking a cigarette. And I read that in Paris in the 20s, it was illegal. I mean, I can't wrap my mind around that for women to wear pants, and that Cahin and other members of the lesbian community like Sylvia Beach deliberately wore them as an act of defiance. So I'm so interested in this project of yours. Did you tell me you're looking at 43?
Yeah, I'm looking, it's, people are going to be like, what? It's just not what I think you think of when I say the movie A League of Their Own, but it's a reincarnation of The League of Their Own. And from what I've said so far, you can see the difference. It's in the early 40s. And so that was very much illegal in a lot of places. And just, it was not just like, maybe unless you were working in a factory like Rosie the Riveter type situation,
right. Huh. Oh, I guess we have to move on. I have all these other things. So we'll move on, I guess. But we'll come back to Claude Cahin. So you have to do another podcast. And then
I know.
Who you talk, one person you talk about, because there just is so much
more to say.
Yeah. Oh, can I tell you one last thing? I brought a quote for you about Kaha.
Okay.
Once said, "Under this mask, another mask, I will never finish removing all these faces," end quote.
And I'm going to cry on MoMA's YouTube. Hey, can you email me that?
I was just wondering if that was something like you would relate to, or then I wondered, is it just something actors do, projecting yourself?
I feel like I relate to it more as just a human being.
Yes, yeah.
I think the actor part is maybe like the last one.
Yeah.
That's the frivolous one that I get paid to put on.
Yes.
But then the ones that I maybe struggle with are the ones that I'm not paid to put on. It's like, who am I being with? But I think everyone feels that way.
Yeah. Now I thought it was so poignant in a way, because it almost is like the situation of infinite regress.
Well, I guess a positive spin could be also sometimes putting on a different version of yourself can actually be great.
Yes, exactly. That's very true. So, all right. Shall we switch to Merritt Oppenheim? Shall
yes.
we look our one more friend. Time at that fur teacup?
Yes.
So this we talked about before, and I thought it was all right that we would come back to it. It's probably one of the so best known surrealist objects. And I think one of the things when we spoke about it that I'd mentioned was Oppenheim made this when she was only 23. And she lived into her 70s up until 1985. And I think she made, like, spent the rest of her career trying to get out from under the fame of this object. And I wondered if sometimes if you ever feel that, what do I really want to ask you? I didn't know if with, you do so many different things.
I think that the when something goes well
yeah.
early in yeah. your career,
yeah,
there's has to be a pressure. Yeah. I feel that right now where it, you know, it was never like a massive like ratings hit, but it was, you know, more than a lot. Like it went the exact way I would have could have ever asked for in right. terms of like just how it was put out. I don't know. I love that project. And I think I will spend a little bit of time trying to find what that felt like for me yes. making that.
Yep.
Yeah. Cause it was so special, but also I think I probably will be defined by that for a long time, but I think I'm okay with it. It's a lot of pressure though, where you're like, well, maybe everyone, like, you know, can I make something that's
right
entertaining again?
Yes. Yeah.
It sounds like she was like frustrated by it.
I think like if we look at the next slide I brought, if these guys can do that, I wanted to, so this is a
oh, painting wow.
she made and she left this. So the fur teacup came to MoMA in 1936 and as part of an exhibition. And although everybody always thinks we bought it in 36, we didn't. Like Alfred Barr, the director, had to buy it himself. The trustees refused to buy it. And he tried and tried and anyway, kept on an extended loan. Long story short, it wasn't until the like 60s that it was promoted into the collection proper, even though it was so famous. But when Oppenheim, in her will, she left us this painting from 1936, the same year as the teacup. And I think it was to say, so look, you know,
see what else
I did. And I mean, this picture here or there takes a whole other discussion. And
I mean, maybe I we'll love just, this, but you would never think that this is the same artist.
Right. And her whole body of work is like that. In fact, the teacup and object making was a very small part of her practice by the time she got to be in her 70s. And yet the teacup was so famous.
I mean, it kind of reminds me of musicians when they put out like an album. That,
yes.
Like, hits it and then right. you get the next album and it's like they're just artists exploring what they're currently
right.
you know curious about and fascinated with, but it's not the thing that was like the hit
right.
And then it's like you don't want the hit not to exist, but you want to be able to explore other mediums
right.
and it, right. it really
right
but this is I really love this. I don't know what other artists it like reminds me of somebody.
I don't know. There's so many, many right? different ones. She was, looks a little to me like a little Arpi or Picabia with mechanical lines. I really like the title, Redhead.
Wait, do you call it Picabia? Like Picasso it?
Oh, Picabia. Well, Francis Picabia was an
okay, artist. I think you were saying Picassoian or something. And I was like, well, what? I thought you were using like a way of saying Picasso in a different way. And I was like, I've never heard that. You're saying a different artist.
I'm saying a different artist. That's fine. Actually, I know Sean is telling us we should look at some more pictures.
Sean, we're trying.
We're trying. We have to zip
on. We're having too much fun, Sean. Okay.
So wait, let's get Fred. Fred, can you keep clicking through these pictures? Because I just brought... Oh, this was just to show you Merritt Oppenheim in her native Switzerland.
do we want to talk about the cup and saucer at all?
Yes. Yeah, so let's click further, shall we? Let's, because it's going to come back.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
So here in 1967, is Merritt Oppenheim with her fur cup and her saucer and her spoon. And I just wondered what you thought of this picture. Like, is it funny, or does it make you think about that work differently, or is it just like a spoof?
No, I mean, I really enjoy this photo because you rarely get to see artists, I mean, like being witty and playful with their work, especially in the museum.
Yes.
Like, again, why I love talking to you and why I love doing the podcast was because it, no offense mm-hmm. to MoMA, but any huge institution has like this pretentious kind of highbrow air to it. And I always felt that way where I have to like listen to the thing, the audio, and read the placard and be like, yeah, I understand exactly. You know, and you feel like you have to have all the information to like get it. Yes. And this is one where it is like, I would definitely have read the placard and like been so curious, but I love seeing her playing with it because then it lightens it.
Yes, which I
think. And it's not very light. It's like, it feels like there's like weight to like, oh my goodness. Okay. So is it taking like domesticity and flipping it or like what, you know?
Right. No, or is it taking, I don't know, something genteel or cultural and making it bestial or animal?
Right.
All those playing with dichotomies. Is it seductive or is it aggressive? You know, why does it stick in our mind? But I like that photo because I think humor is so important. Well, I don't have to be the one to tell you humor is important.
No, but it is like the last, it's like the last, it's, what's the word where you like, you want to try that, but you're like, no, I don't at all. It's like the last thing I want the cup to be.
To find on your, we were joking about on your breakfast table. That's not what I want my coffee served in. Thank you very much.
Plus, no.
So anyway, I think we have to scoot a little bit. You know, I brought this fun interview of Merritt Oppenheim, but we don't have time. I'll play that for you later.
Okay.
She has this great Swiss accent. And then if we just click, Fred, are you there? Can you just click through these images like 1 second at a time? Maybe. Oh, so then I just, so keep going. One more. This, then maybe we'll end with this one on the whole domesticity thing, because at MoMA, this is a 1936 maybe photograph by Dora Maar, who was another woman artist associated with Surrealist circles and a great photographer. And among the images she took was one of this Merritt Oppenheim fur teacup, but on a napkin.
And the spoon is on the other side.
I know. It's like, so what do we do? And I was saying to you before it turned out, Merritt Oppenheim gave MoMA a napkin in the 70s for us to display this object on. And then before the expansion, because I'd never known about the object, we tried it out. And I have to say, Abbi, I was just too chicken. It just made me feel like it wasn't the art object anymore. And
I like it better without.
Do you?
Oh. I do like it way better without, but it adds, like there's something about like, I would want like a bigger table, or like, if we're gonna add the tablecloth, I want it to be on like a real table.
Let's show the last two things, and then we're gonna look at Frida Kahlo, because we promised we would do that. So I brought you a picture of Merritt Oppenheim. She's putting a little tablecloth on top of a shelf in a vitrine. Oppenheim is the figure at center, the second in from the left. This is the last year of her life at her big retrospective. Wow. And then if we look at the very last photo, so there, that's how.
Full tablecloth, so it's not cut off.
So it's not cut off.
Interesting. So anyway, iron out those folds.
I don't know, or do I like fault. Anyway, just stay tuned because we're working, like you're doing a project about the 40s and I'm working, full disclosure, on a Merritt Oppenheim retrospective.
Oh, wow.
So with the Kunstmuseum Bern and the Menil collection. And so by 2022, I have to decide about the napkin. So anyway.
I want to go to Frida, but I just want to say the napkin makes me think so much like just, you know, when you, it, just every choice, like just the choice of the napkin, just that being so important to the way that, like, I don't even know what I'm saying, but just thinking about that being like a change, it's going to change the whole piece. And what are we, like, I love, like, you just don't often, I go back and forth of being like, wow, like a choice can drastically change. And then I'm like, not being precious with the choices. I don't know what's right. Do you know what I mean? Just right. In terms of like living life.
Yes.
Both are interesting ways of going well, into things.
Yeah. I mean, maybe it's just always like every situation merits a different response or a different presentation or a-
You mean Merritt Oppenheim's a different-
Oh, that was so bad. Okay.
We They're like going to kick me off. They're like, bye, Abby. Okay, bye.
Oh, but I love, nobody's done that pun yet. All these 2 years I've been working on the show.
You needed me to come on the Zoom. Yeah, and that's why I'm here, okay? Okay, Frida.
Frida. So guys, show us Frida Kahlo. Thank you very much. Okay. So... Well, I guess I love every single work we chose, Abby, so can't really say this. So this is a self-portrait, like Kahlo's art was, of her in 1940, the year after her divorce from Diego Rivera, and... she pictures herself, as you can see here, seated in a chair. It's actually a chair that was like one in her studio in the aftermath of a haircut that she, judging from the scissors in her lap, has self-administered. And I don't know where to begin with this work. It has the lyrics of a song up above, so it has images and words. Do you read Spanish? I sort of know what it says. It says, you know, look, I loved you for your hair, or if I loved you for your hair, now that you've cut your hair off, I don't love you anymore. So she sort of put this.
I didn't know what it said before. Wow. So it's a lyric of a song, but I almost interpreted that that's what someone would have said to her.
Yeah, or maybe that's what she wanted us to think, this sort of, I don't know, lament or address. I don't know if it's something that like she's dismissing, you know, the superficiality of someone loving somebody just for their hair.
I love everyone we've looked at, but I mean, and I think everyone, probably if you came into this knowing Frida Kahlo more. I'm from Philly, and the Philadelphia Museum of Art had like a big, maybe a retrospective, is that what it's called?
Yes, like, yes.
A couple years ago, I took my mom. When things open up again, they will, if that ever happens again with her work, yeah. It blew me away. Her work is unreal. This is in 1940. It's just like... Yes. In all the ways, it's like devastating. And then she's like the ultimate badass. And it's like brave and bold and heartbreaking. It's like all of it. Yes. And gorgeous.
Yes, yes, yes. I mean, I think that is so, the ultimate badass is really sort of spot on for me. Because I think like I've always looked at, they're not always, I've been interested in the way she's wearing a man's suit. Mm-hmm. And then the way that it is, you know, Kala once said when she was asked, or when she was speaking about surrealism, she said, they thought I was a surrealist, but I wasn't. I never painted dreams. I painted my own reality. And I think for me, this picture sort of just speaks to that in such an amazing way of how she could take this private personal experience of having cut off her hair in the after divorcing her husband, donning his suit, but showing herself here, like not only vulnerable, but also very capable, right? She's like an amazing artist who went on to put a private personal experience like that at the very center of her public practice. And I guess, you know, that seems
always vulnerable.
Yeah.
But like, so in like, it has the intensity of the photo, the first Claude.
Yes.
Cajon. But she does that a lot. It's like direct eye contact with us.
Right. Right.
And it is like, oh yeah. Come on.
And I think, so for me too, art history wise, just saying this sort of a very particular feminine subjectivity, Kahlo insists and proves again and again can be the subject matter for making this very deadly serious universal art. So this is like an amazing one. Oh, here we have a question from Jody Klaus. How would you say feminism shapes the art world? And how do we tell our stories from a female perspective instead of through the male gaze?
It's such a like catch 22 because I actually don't like being, I don't like my gender to come before all of my work.
Yes.
But it does most of the time. And like, so while I love we're talking about a group of women, it's like this thing of like, but can't, like, why can't we just be talking about artists and they happen to be women? You know what I mean? Like,
yes.
It's this like, yes. I don't know if that's like kind of part of the question. I don't know if I answered it, but like.
Right. Yeah. Why do we need to have a separate space?
but we do because there's clearly not space. There's like just not an equal space at all.
Right. And it's we've just become so aware, increasingly aware. I think it's great that like awareness is just building and flooding over about how inequitable histories, not just art histories, have been.
Can I ask you as a curator, do you feel, how do you feel like in terms of like, without making anything too intense, like how do you feel as a curator? You've worked in this an institution for a long time where probably a lot of the people working there are you're a female curator, I'm sure, in a way too. Like, do you feel it from the outside and then also in the work? Do you feel a pressure or do you feel like you're up against? Not I don't want you to feel uncomfortable and have to like, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
what I'm saying, but
yeah.
You're just up against it regardless because art history is already so skewed male. So
right, I feel as though being aware of that is something to work to correct. I don't know if that really answers the question. I mean, it's like acknowledging how closed the doors had been. Means we have to work every day to make sure that they are opened wider and that they stay open and that the stories we tell on our walls are representative, not just of some one particular segment of society.
Right, because it is, again, I'm not like an art historian, but like the narrative has been primarily like white men, and it's not like women and people of color and women of color weren't making artwork.
Right.
Like what? Right. It's like, oh no, only white men were making it. Like, right. What are we talking about?
Right. You know,
everyone's been making art, right. But it's just been closed, like so many institutions. Right. So it's,
right. Yeah. So it's important to get, and I think, Merritt Oppenheim always said, like, her problem was not her gender. Her problem was how society treated people, right, of her gender. So we in institutions, I think, have a special responsibility. Oh, look at this 8-4. So, all right. So all we get to do is like flash quickly on Leonora Carrington.
Oh, right. Okay.
Even though we didn't stay very long on Frida Kahlo.
So I know.
We definitely.
Well, this is like, we're doing like little drive-bys here.
Part two.
Yeah.
Part two. So here is the last picture.
Oh, yeah.
You, wow, and I picked. And so I guess from what you said at the beginning, this is by an artist named Leonora Carrington. And she.
Wow. Oh, yeah. There's the whole thing.
Yeah, was a British expatriate who painted in Mexico City and who knew Frida Kahlo. And I'm just curious, although I guess I'm not curious anymore, because I'm gathering she wasn't a name that you, or a artist you were familiar with before.
No. I mean, it's so interesting with paintings like this. They're not the ones that I'm usually like,
yes,
obsessed with.
Yes.
But they're fascinating where, right, I try to figure out, like, there's a clear narrative that the artist, yeah, is like expressing, whether it's a dream, like stemming from a dream, or the imagination, or just like there's something she's trying to convey. There's like a story.
Right.
Yes. And it's like interesting of like, where do you start? You know what I mean? I love the clouds and the storm and the ceiling kind of, it's gorgeous.
Right. No, I know. I think it's definitely the most narrative or storybook or theatrical even. I would,
yeah,
theatrical in a sense of making us very conscious of this being staged.
It does feel almost like a play, like a scene from a play.
What is the plot?
Yeah, what is the plot?
I mean, it has this crazy title. And then we saw The Daughter of the Minotaur. So Carrington was really interested in magic and in alchemy and in witchcraft and in female power. And so I think the one thing I would say about this, if we go back or if they click through, because this central image and that figure is always said to be sort of one of Carrington's many surrogate selves. So she, oh, wow, was always working sort of personal narratives into her art by adopting, right, these personas. And in this case, the center white figure was inspired by a book called The White Goddess. And the White Goddess was a mythic figure who combined the powers of love and destructiveness and poetic inspiration, and who ruled during a matriarchal period before she was deprived of her power. And so I suppose, I don't know, what am I thinking here? I just was thinking this kind of brings us a loop around, because Carrington is putting on a costume, right? She's another, it's another sort of persona or performance. And in this case, a performance of female power,
yeah,
in this crazy picture. That's also a family portrait with her two sons
over, wow, to
the right. And what we're told, the Minotaur was a surrogate for her husband, a photographer named Cheeky. Anyway, so
she really changes everything. Wow. No, I mean, it's so interesting even to look at the four artists and they're in the same, like, it makes sense to me that they are in the same movement, but again, like, they're so different, and like, it's really just about the idea of the expression behind it versus the actual, like,
yes, yes, the style or the motive.
Yeah, movement. Yeah, yeah.
Like, yeah, which is, I guess that's part of the key to surrealism, is it was an idea, it was an intellectual revolution of sorts.
I know we're getting to question time, but I have like kind of a bigger question.
Okay, I'm ready.
So I know we're talking surrealism, and we can come back to it if people have surrealism questions. But okay, so this was like 100 years ago.
Yes.
when surrealism began, right? After World War I. And we're also in like a, in quite a tumultuous time and in a very like anti-establishment time, which is obviously something that continues happening in history.
Right.
Do you think that, I know like Breton, you know, named surrealism as it was happening.
Right.
But like, okay, do you think, one, do you feel like we might be in an artistic movement right now? I know this is a big question, but like, if so, like, what, look, it, like, I only imagine what kind of art would come out of this moment we're in. And also, like, do you think we would know it if we were, like, at the moment? Or is our history defined in the future? Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Well, I can tell you my personal opinion about this, which maybe many would disagree with. I think that the present is always plural, and it's hard to make sense of. And I do think that it's historians who go back and give names or categories to things. And I just think I've seen one of the things I've enjoyed so much during this, you know, these sort of terrible times that we are living through, this is going to sound so self-centered and selfish in a way. It's just when the galleries in Chelsea reopened and going to see some of the work that's been made by artists during quarantine, like that just, I found so moving, and that some creative can come out of this time. But and then back to your, but it all looked really different, right?
And but you feel, yeah, it all, it wasn't, it didn't feel like it was in a category, but do you feel like, this is like a bigger question too, sorry guys, but like, do you feel like, okay, the gallery's open, all this work's been made in quarantine, but you're also seeing it from the quarantine.
Yes.
Like you are longing for that. Like, so you're bringing something that it's like a, that's what it is, right?
Right. No, so it's like,
30 years from now, it will be viewed totally differently, but you're seeing it in this like vulnerable state. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. No, I mean, that's always, I think the great thing about art is it changes all the time, depending on like where we're at.
Yeah.
This will sound corny, and then I think we have to have some live questions.
Sorry, I've been asking too many questions.
Yeah, no, they're great questions, because I can say that when I got back to MoMA after being quarantined, all the works look different to me.
Oh, wow.
They all look different, but that's for another day. They just
reading a book again.
Yeah.
In a different time in your life, and you're like, wow, that.
That's going to speak to me in a different way, different voice. So this is a question, Abbi, from Barbara Goldberg. Oh, we have like two minutes left. Barbara Goldberg asks, can we discuss the social statements within the pieces of these women? I'm interested in those social statements that have not changed, thereby making this art especially relevant today. On a personal side note, Abbi, I love your work. It's fun to see you, as I'm also an artist and your mom's high school buddy.
Somewhere, someone from my life had to come in. Barbara, thank you. I will tell my mom that you say hello. Cherry Hill, all the way.
And do you think, I mean, I thought the question was a good one. Are there social statements in these works?
I think like gender, for sure. And like how we identify ourselves and present, and like the mask wearing and taking off and putting on that you're talking about is definitely, I mean, weirdly, the teacup is gendered.
Yes.
Because that's like, I mean, like objects in our society are sometimes gendered in like a fucked up way.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Which makes,
I don't know if that answers the question.
No, it's fine. I mean, to digress on the like gendering of objects, I've always thought it's interesting in the Romance languages that they have the pronouns, right? Or feminine or masculine, which we sort of dispense with our English.
But she messes with that. She makes it,
absolutely,
like you said, beastly. She makes it non what we expect gender wise. It's like It's all the things, which is like how we all should be. Like, they're all actually making themselves not what we think of as traditionally feminine or female.
Yes. Yes. I think maybe it might be fair to say with all of, maybe not, I was going to say, like all of these works trouble binaries, right? Yeah. Like the dichotomies between male, female, nature, culture, inside, outside, like every single one of
that's
them.
That's a way better way of saying it. That. That's why you do what you do, I do what I do.
So I think we have, it's 8:58. Oh my gosh. Here, I have to go down. I'm sorry. All you people ask such great questions and there's so many here. I'm just scrolling along. Puerto Rico. Oh, I'm sorry, Joannette. I'm going to our final question from Stephanie Inzuza. And she wants to know, Abbi, how does surrealism influence you?
Ooh. I think for me, it influences me in that I don't want to make work that is always what you would expect. Mm-hmm. Like, I want to subvert, like, the element, like, not just not the obvious, not the obvious choice, or like going the second step to being like, this is actually a different way in, or a different way of like looking at this idea or this space or this thing, rather than going straight toward it. I think surrealism kind of goes like a different way to get there or something, which I have to like remind myself right now. I'm in a writing mode, mm-hmm. and I'm like, okay, we could just do it like, we could do it just like this and tell it like kind of a traditional way. Right. Or let's just think for a second about the not like what people would not expect. And like, oh, tell it this way. Like, there's so many ways of going and talking about the thing.
Right, right, right. And surrealism says, it encourages, right? It almost gives, I don't know, it's not the right word. It encourages.
To go against the norm or the usual way, right?
I love that. I think that's like a great way of, I was thinking for me, it's always a reminder on the one hand that things are not what they seem.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
And that listening to things that are hard to express, or dreams or desires or fantasy, like that's as important as the rational self, right?
It is a reminder, even in just like listening to you talk about it. I didn't know that it was so big. I mean, obviously I knew a little bit that it was based on dreams and, mm-hmm. but it does feel like it's about paying attention to like the inner self.
Right.
And like that, the other, like the parts of ourselves. which I love investigating. So yeah.
Me too. So hey, so I think us 901, like we went over time. I just have
to- Don't get mad at us, guys.
Yeah, don't get mad at us, audience. Thank you for hanging in there. And if you weren't able to be here for the whole time live, this video will be up on MoMA.org for viewing immediately afterwards. And now I get to do this. We've had viewers tune in from all over the world.
Can I say thank you to you? And then, because you have a thing. So Anne, thank you for having me. You are such a joy. Please, I can't wait till we can do this in person. Oh. And thank you. This has been so fun. Everyone that came, I wish I could see your faces. But it just a reminder, like MoMA has been so lovely and asked me to do this stuff. But I hope it was an opportunity for you to like go away from all the fucking bullshit we're going through right now. And think about some other things that can be applied to everyday life, and just to like go and investigate and be curious about stuff. So thank you so much for having me. It like made my week. It made my month. This was great.
For me too. So anytime, come back. Let's go to other places. Oh, so now, all right. So now I'm going to do my little thing.
Yeah, go, go, go.
I'm going to say thank you to just hang in there because I'm coming back to you at the end. So we have had viewers tune in from all over the world. People are joining us right now in Arizona, Brazil, Brooklyn, Buenos Aires, California, Chicago, Colombia, Finland, Florida, Germany, India, Kentucky, Malaysia, wow, Mexico, Miami, Montreal, Nashville, New York, New Zealand, Ohio, the Philippines, Puerto Rico, Seattle, Sweden, and the UK. And I'm sure I'm leaving some out. Please, everybody, remember to stay up to date with what's happening at MoMA on magazine and MoMA.org. And be sure to tune in for our next virtual views next week, where we'll be exploring one of MoMA's most beloved works, Vincent van Gogh's Starry Night, with a dramatic reading of Van Gogh's letters to his brother Theo, read by Anna Deavere Smith. So that'll be next Thursday, December 3rd at 8:00 Eastern Standard Time. And then finally, we'd like, Abbi and I would both like to thank all of you out there in our digital audience. And then I just want most of all to say thank you to Abbi, looking at art and talking about ideas large and small and domestic and grand is just the absolute best. So I wish you a good week and good writing, and that I get to see you again soon.
You
so
too.
Bye, everybody.
And everyone, keep wearing masks. We got this.
Yes, right. Yes, we're only because we're in Zoom rooms. That's why we don't have them on.
Yeah.